Amen. Amen.
It's only the third time I've been up here in this pulpit with the bird's eye view. I can see you all, so step straight. Now, anyone who is sensitive to the oppression of women in our society, and especially in those of less developed countries, might take offense at today's reading from Mark's Gospel. After all, one minute, Simon's dear old mother is in bed with a fever, and the next, she's springing out of bed to wait on Jesus and the disciples. We've all known women like that, haven't we? The wife and mother is constantly in the kitchen, preparing and serving food, rarely taking time out to sit down with the men. We've all known women who work themselves to an early grave by caring for others with no regard for self-care. Women who were perpetually put upon, downtrodden, completely taken for granted, and kept in a state of virtual servitude. God knows this goes on all over the world. Yeah, but no, Simon's mother is not one of those women. And to assume so, which is easy to do because feminist critics rightly point out that it certainly is striking that her behavior does seem to reflect a general condition of women in society. That's really not the point of this story. And if you get hung up on that, you really do miss a lot. If we're able to bracket our 21st century sensibilities for one moment, we can learn so much from this short but incredibly meaningful passage that we heard this morning. Now, Mark's Gospel, as you probably remember, is short on words and straight to the point. This means that each line requires a bit of unpacking, and I invite you to join me in taking a second look at this passage. You can pull out your bulletin if you'd like to do that. Now, to set the stage, you should remember that just one chapter earlier, Jesus is in the synagogue, and he's begun his ministry now, and he's in the synagogue, he starts teaching, and people are amazed, and they say, what kind of authority does this guy have? They're astounded at his teaching. And the strange thing also that occurs in the synagogue is that a man with an unclean spirit comes forward, and Jesus heals him. He evacuates the unclean spirit from the man. And the demon comes out, recognizes Jesus in his identity right away. And this is because the authority with which Jesus teaches is the authority of the highest power, the transcendent creator of all, who is above all that is good and evil in our world. And Jesus has this cosmic power, this cosmic authority, that is not recognized by his followers right away, but paradoxically is recognized by the evil ones, the demons. And so Jesus has authority over all that is good and all that is not good, all that is unhealthy, that lacks wholeness, that is evil. And so this is a very And so this action prefigures his action of resurrection at the end of the Gospel of Mark. This is a foreshadowing of many similar occurrences of resurrection throughout this chapter, and a foreshadowing of the final resurrection of Jesus, who becomes the Christ. But this is such a lovely scene to imagine Jesus coming to this woman on her sickbed, taking her by the hand and lifting her up. When you think about your loved ones whom you love but see no longer, people who have preceded you into heaven, or maybe when you think about your own final moments on the earth, isn't it wonderful to have this vision in mind of Jesus coming to you, taking you by the hand, and lifting you up? It's a beautiful image, and it's one worth holding on to, meditating on, as you think about our final days here on the planet. Now, Jesus takes Simon's, Peter's mother's hand, lifts her up, and he evacuates the illness from her. She is healed. And this is the same thing that happened in the synagogue. He evacuated the evil spirit, and the unclean man was healed of the demon. Jesus is showing his authority over all that is evil, all that is unhealthy, all that is not whole or holy. She is healed, made whole, given new life by her encounter with Jesus, the healer. What is it that you need to be healed of as you sit here this morning? Perhaps there's an illness that is worrying you. Perhaps there is uncertainty about a potential diagnosis. Or perhaps you're not physically sick, but you're heart sick, disappointed, lonely, depressed. So many people are these days. Can you close your eyes for a moment as you sit here and imagine Jesus extending his hand to you, raising you up? Can you imagine feeling his healing power like the strongest sunshine on your face, lifting this burden off of your shoulders? Suddenly, you feel lighter. You can breathe again, move again. Still with your eyes closed, look over at Jesus. What are you feeling? How will you respond? Perhaps with a smile. Perhaps with a hug and a kiss. Or perhaps with the urge to do something for him in return. What is Jesus calling you to do? If your eyes are closed, you can open them. too, probably, that by serving others, we find ourselves, the best part of ourselves, and we become fully human, fully whole in ourselves. We take the focus off of ourselves and put it on the needs of others. Just think about that story this morning. Jesus heals the one person, Simon Peter's mother. And what happens next? The word gets out, and dozens more show up at the door. The work is endless. And that is good news for you and me, because we have so many opportunities to serve. And in doing so, to become whole ourselves, to learn about ourselves, and to deepen our faith. We're spoiled for opportunities to serve here in San Francisco. In fact, sometimes it's difficult to discern exactly what God is calling us to, because the opportunities just seem endless. You know, you might not see this as a blessing, but I remember serving a church in Connecticut, in Litchfield County, which is sort of jokingly thinks of itself as rural, but in fact it's where a lot of rich New Yorkers have their country homes. And it's a lot of artists there, a lot of writers, famous writers, William Starr there, and Alexander Calder, the local artist, Vanity Fair editor Greg Carter, I baptized his baby. They live there. These people go from very expensive accommodation in Manhattan out to their country place. One day, we received a large check to be used for outreach. They sat there scratching their heads, not knowing how this money was going to be spent, because there weren't opportunities to benefit the community. It was just such a wealthy community. We have so many here, so many opportunities to serve, but in fact, I'm not joking when I say that these people in Litchfield County at this very wealthy church were poor because they lacked opportunities for spiritual growth and for service to others. I mean, yes, they could serve one another, they could visit one another in the hospital, they could make a meal when someone died, but really encountering Christ in people who are so very different from us was not an opportunity that they had very freely. You know, I've just spent a couple of months that were intended for me to get some healing, and it certainly was effective in that way. It was a sudden relief. It was not one that I orchestrated, but it had a very good result. With the opportunity to pray and refresh myself, I was healed and lifted up by Jesus. And guess what?